Would you like to just begin by telling me what are the objectives of your class today?
So this course that I teach is called Philosophy of Education, where we hope that at the end of the course, the students would be able to think philosophically on issues that are of central concern to education, right? And the kind of philosophical thinking that we want them to engage in requires a kind of skill or practice, if one can call that practice, of going into their own minds and trying to look into what they are thinking and find assumptions that are governing their own thoughts. So this particular class today was actually the first class in a series of lectures where they were supposed to push themselves a little differently in terms of thinking than they were doing before. So we were discussing this topic called aims of education, and this particular paper essentially points to the problem with the educational domain now, where the entire educational practice is only seen as a means to serve certain ends. One can call it ends of the economy or liberal ends. In this particular paper, the author basically tries to help us recognize that our mind is thinking in a certain manner, mm-hmm. which is in the means and ends thinking model. And probably it is important for us to relook at this nature of thinking when it at least comes to issues regarding education and educational practices. Mm-hmm. And that was the objective of mm-hmm. the class, to introduce them by making them recognize this model that is there in their head, and also try to think a little differently.
Were you able to meet the objectives? How did you feel about how the class went?
Meeting the objectives would require, I think, a few more classes. Mm-hmm. But today I was only interested in ensuring that they are able to recognize this model of thinking. And that much I feel from the answers and from the questions that has come in the class, that they were able to get the drift of their own minds, right? Mm-hmm. Now, the next step is to push them and ask them to think or justify the enterprise of education or the practice of education mm-hmm. As integral to human life without grounding it on some other goals or some other aims of education.
So tell me, Ajita, for this particular class, you had a prior reading, or did you just start off by building on the argument that you had planned, or was it an expectation that all students should have come prepared, having read what you had asked them to, or?
Yeah. In generally all our classes, the expectation is that they come having read not the entire reading, but at least part of the reading with some questions that they can some questions, some burning questions in their mind that they can formulate and then ask in the class, so that they can engage with the entire classroom pedagogy in a much more fruitful manner. So yes, there was an expectation to have read something and come to the class having read it.
How do you deal with a class of 45 students where I'm sure not all 45 of them read, and even if they do, they probably don't necessarily understand what they have read, because a lot of philosophy of education readings can be quite terse. So how do you deal with when you feel that there are students who clearly have not done their homework, or who have not, or are not able to follow what is happening in class entirely? It's a challenge for all of us, I think, as teachers.
I think it is a big challenge to deal with a class of 45, I wouldn't say students, 45 minds thinking in so many different ways and trying to relate to the discussion that's happening here from their own vantage points, right? Mm. From their own prejudices, biases, or conditioning, okay? Mm. So I think the first challenge is not just the size in terms of the number, but in terms of the minds that are operating here in this
yes.
classroom, right?
Yes.
So that is the first challenge. The second point that you referred to regarding what to do if they have not read and come in the class. So at least as a philosophy of education facilitator, I do not actually enter the class with the assumption that that they would have come here having read it.
Right.
Okay. Also, if they've come read it, as you said, there is a problem in terms of probably they've not understood what they've read. Okay. So what I do in the class is also try to explain the paper by presenting a conceptual map, going argument by argument, point by point in the paper. The second thing is to ensure that they're actually understanding what is being even said in the classroom. What I try to do is actually have them talk in small groups or in pairs after a significantly important point has been discussed. Share their thoughts with each other so that it helps in consolidating what they have understood, hearing other person talk to them, and then probably changing and shifting what they've understood already, and then sharing that discussion with everyone here in the class, and then again tying that up together. I think that helps in ensuring that they're all on the same page, whether they have come read to the class or not.
So I see that you use the board quite extensively in your class, and you refer to the term conceptual map. Could you tell us a little more about this form of pedagogy? I find it rather fascinating and interesting. Tell me how and why do you use it extensively in your class?
I'm happy that you find it fascinating and interesting. I think this particular way of teaching, I did not think of it as a teaching strategy to begin with. I think I used conceptual maps as a strategy for me to understand a paper. It was a personal revelation that that laying out the concepts as a map and connecting them in a certain form in which the thinker or the author has written them helps in understanding and grasping the paper in its totality. Because you can also keep going back to where the flaws are in the argument, where the loopholes are, etc. Right? And then I started using it a year ago in the class, just trying it out as an experiment. And it appeared that the feedback from the students was that it actually helped them understand the paper being discussed in the class, also because every single concept that was discussed was there right in front of them, visually on the board. And also they started taking photographs of these maps or copying those maps that I had made and go back to their readings with the map next to them. And apparently it also helped them understand their readings a little more better than they had understood it before. And some students also tried making their own maps. So in that sense, it began from my own journey of trying to understand a very difficult paper. And then just sharing what your journey is with students.
Right.
And that's how it has helped me.
So in the beginning, you mentioned that students of philosophy of education have to be attuned to philosophical forms of thinking in education. Is that a challenge for all philosophy of or philosophy instructors in general? And how do you work around that? How hard is it? Do you think that by the end of one semester or two semesters, they are able to achieve that? How does it work for a philosophy instructor?
I think that's a very difficult question to answer, how it really happens. I'll start from a different place, right? So to me personally, thinking philosophically resolves a few things that I am undergoing in my own life, okay? And there may not be a particular method that I can lay out as the method to say that this is what philosophical thinking is.
Absolutely.
A lot of times philosophical thinking is understood in what it has done to you when you're actually thinking philosophically. So in the spirit of sharing, I try to be as open in the way I'm thinking and presenting that thinking to the students as I am thinking through in the class about a certain idea. And one hopes that students are paying attention, careful attention to how someone is actually thinking, and then are trying to adapt it to their own needs, right? Apart from that, we use a few strategies, like we would ask them to go into their own minds, we would ask them to describe what they're seeing when they're thinking about a concept, etc. But I think they can only take us so far. What really takes them really far is to be able to pay attention to what the instructor in the class is doing and adapt it to their own situation, their own life experiences.
Are you also able to incorporate that in the assessments that you carry out?
So what I'm thinking is, yes, so even in the assessments, there is a certain demand we place on them when they're writing their assessments, right? So so if they are making a claim, if they're saying something, they will have to carefully look at each concept that constitutes the claim and explain these concepts the way they understand it, okay? And this particular demand that we place on them during assessments also helps them get to the place where we want them to get to. Thank you for pointing that out. Yeah.
So just one last question about student engagement and participation in class. How do you ensure student participation? Especially, I always find that, like I said earlier, challenging when there are so many students and there is a tendency for some students to, you know, participate a lot more than others do. They are also more articulate. How do you overcome that? And really would like to hear that from you as a co-instructor. Yeah.
I think one probably has to understand what does participation even mean in a classroom. We seem to be largely hung up on this idea that participation actually means that they are talking, that they are sharing to the instructor what their thoughts are. I'm not saying that it's not participation. I'm saying that, yes, that is also an integral dimension to participation. But there are people who don't really want to share what they're thinking, or very doubtful, very skeptical of whether what they're thinking is actually right, or whether it is even worthwhile to share them, etc. So instead of actually pushing them to speak, what I ask them to do is actually talk to each other. Like, to me, participation also means that they're able to speak to someone they're comfortable with, sharing their very very nascent, initially formed thoughts, right? They're just in their nascent stages. And I think that helps them consolidate their learning in a much more grounded manner. So to me, participation involves this idea that they're talking to each other. And a lot of times, it's also talking outside the classroom as well.
Yeah.
That it's not always in the 90-minute lecture that they have to speak. They can actually speak outside the classroom, which just shows us that their mind was engaged when the lecture was happening, even if they did not speak. I think that in itself is a good
indicator
for me that they are actually participating.
Yeah.
Right. So that's how I think about it.
Right. I really enjoyed this conversation with you, and thank you for being here and sharing your insights about philosophy of education.
Thanks a lot for asking these questions and making me think a little bit more about my own practice.
Thanks a lot.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm happy that you're all here today. And I'm going to start off from where we left off in the last class, right? So I'll just give a very quick summary, very, very quick summary of the first and the second paper that we've already discussed. And then we'll move on to the third paper, so that you're able to place the third paper in the context of the first and the second paper, right? If you remember, in the first paper, what we discussed specifically was the concept of education. And we took a specific strand, the strand of liberal education, from R.S. Peters' point of view to understand this concept called education, right? That's where you were introduced to some new notions or terms, such as intrinsically worthwhile, and the idea of knowledge, in breadth and depth, right? Please pay attention to this, right? So this was not just the aim of education that we were talking about, okay? This was only the concept of education, a mental object called education, and what notions form the concept, right? What criteria forms this concept called education? That is, if you take away one of these, then it would not be called education. This is what the first paper was all about, right? It is in the second paper Winch and Jindal's paper on values, aims, and society, we actually hit upon the idea of an aim. Okay? That is where we actually discussed the aims of education. And the way, but even before discussing the aims of education, Winch and Jindal presented us what the concept actually means, right? And they said the concept actually just means preparation for life, is it not, right? And when we say it is preparation for life, it leads us to questions of what kind of life? Once we have some clarity about what kind of life one wants to or one needs to or one should live, then that will basically give us the aims that we all aspire for, okay? And those aims will become aims of education. This is also in relation to one of the questions that was asked yesterday, that what are these things called aims of education, right? Aims are some things that we seem to decide vis-a-vis our idea of life or idea of good life. And then we kind of say that education should help us realize this idea of a good life. And that is what aims of education would mean. And you did here discuss a few more things, that life itself consists of a liberal aspect, a civic aspect, and a vocational aspect. Right? So far, so good. And then Winch was also pushing us to engage with the relationship between education and economy. Is it? Do you remember this? Right. This places us in a very good vantage point, okay? Because the third paper starts taking issues with the idea of economy completely appropriating the practice of education. That is where it starts. And that is the agony one can feel that Paul Standish is going through, okay? I'm assuming that you've read at least the first two sections of the paper a little more thoroughly, right? And it's a difficult paper also to, in that sense, understand at the first read. So today we will discuss this paper in detail, at least the first two sections. Is that okay? You're all with me on this one? Thank you. Right? I did introduce the first section of the paper also by talking about this idea that aims of education, first of all, the concept of education itself is changing, is contextual, is political and historically constructed, right? Which makes it contested, right? Contestations is a fight, correct? So in that sense, the aims of education are contested. And if you ask me what governs these contestations, one can easily connect this also back to Winch and Jindal's paper when he spoke of conflict of values also, right? So each context, each time, each political and historical context seems to have people, you know, latching on to some values, right? Things that they think very highly of, and they think that education should help them achieve these ideas that they are latching on to, right? So in that sense, it is contested. Now, the nature of contestation is also at times personalized, right? So sometimes it is not even the values that the society thinks is appropriate. You may also think that in opposition to what the society thinks is appropriate, that you know what, this should be the most supreme or the overgoverning, overarching value that should govern life, right? Yes or no? So in that sense, the aims of education are also personalized as well, right? Not just contested from a socio-political point of view, but also from a personalized point of view. But it seems so that today in society, we have come to this understanding that we don't have to actually spend time thinking about aims of education, because in reality, we seem to think that it is not contested at all, right? There is no contestation here at all, because the aims of education should be commonsensical. In the sense that it is self-evident, What does this mean? And what is the aim of education that is so self-evident, that is so commonsensical, that it should serve the economy? Okay? And why do we think it should serve the economy? Very simple argument, right? So any education system, any centralized education system, requires state support. Now, if the state has to support education, then it has to spend resources. Let's say resources now. Not just money, money, right? So money is just a tool that kind of governs our life. So resources. Now, if the state has to provide for education by sharing the public resources, then the state has to be economically prosperous. And how can a state become economically prosperous? Only if the citizens are economically productive. Right? That they're actually working in some sort of an economic system, right? Some sort of occupation that they're actually doing that is contributing to wealth creation of the state. Now, if people have to work in some occupation to create wealth for the state, then they have to be trained to be able to do something. Correct? People will not be able to do any occupation without any sort of training. Correct? They need some knowledge. They need some skills that helps them work in these occupations. And the solution to that problem is that education should actually train the citizen to contribute back to economy. You see the circle there? Right, so there is no way we can even think out of this box once we say that whatever is supported by public resources, by state resources, by spending its money, etc., needs a return. Right, if there is an investment, it needs a return. If one thinks in that particular model, then it may be very hard for us to first of all escape this idea of creating economically productive citizens. Okay. Yeah.
Are we saying here whether the aim of education is only to serve the economy or also to serve the economy?
So thank you for asking that question. His question is our position here that the aim of education should be only to serve the economy? Or are we saying there are other aims also, but one of the aims of education is to serve the economy? Do you all have the same question in your head, right? So. Very interesting question. It also takes me to a different problem that I want to resolve here, right? So what happens when we read these philosophy papers is that the author is also trying to present the position of other people. And sometimes when we miss that particular strand, we end up thinking that the author's position is also this, okay? But this is definitely not the author's position. The author seems to say that public at large, okay? Seems to think that the aim of education is to serve the economy. Now, I'm not going to emphasize on the word only to serve the economy, just to say that people are not just thinking that alone, right? People are thinking more, but it seems so that we are largely governed. It seems to have captured our imagination that the aim of education actually means to serve the economy, right? I mean, that is the kind of thing he's pointing to. And the dangers of actually taking that route he's going to talk about a bit further. Now, what I want you to do, and also because the task connects with the previous question, what I want you to do is to actually take about 2 or 3 minutes, right? Talk to the person sitting next to you, right? And now I want you to recollect instances in your life where this kind of narrative has been articulated to you, or you've seen people articulating this narrative, right? Instances. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? So talk to the person next to you and think about in your own life, in your own school life, in your conversations with teachers, in your conversations with your parents, with your elders, with other people in the society, or you've overheard conversations of people talking where they are actually articulating that the aim of education is largely to serve the economy. Okay, can you do that? Right? This will actually help you place this argument in your own personal experiences in life. Okay? So 3 minutes, you can talk to each other, and then I'll ask some of you to share those instances where you've heard this. Okay? Thanks. Okay, time up. I think that must have been pretty easy to recollect instances, right? I would be surprised if you had no instances of that kind in your life, right? You've been brought up in a very, very different kind of a school or a setting. Would you volunteer to share some of these instances from your own life?
I'm not so sure if that was my experience, in the sense that education's aim is to serve the economy. It was fundamentally to serve myself,
Okay.
So that I secure myself in my life first, and in order to get a job, which is ultimately serving the economy, but the idea was, I serve myself, and become a useful person to society, and also the idea of gaining an identity.
Gaining an identity as well.
That was the primary concern of the whole concept of education from my own personal experience.
Just for clarification, are you saying that this idea of identity was also somehow linked with the idea of an occupation and a job?
Both in terms of an education, what have you studied?
Okay.
And also the nature of a job that you undertook.
Okay. Thank you. Both dimensions have you've been able to encounter. Okay, thanks.
When I was asking my student after graduation, which kind of particular course do they want to continue as their professional? So most of them were saying medical colleges or engineering. Okay. When I was asking why, because their response was very interesting to me. If we do medical college or engineering college, then we are going to have a good job and a good salary. Then we are going to have a good social position.
Okay. That leading to a good social position. Okay. Links a lot with the previous answer that somehow the interesting dimension is somehow serving the economy is also not seen from an altruistic place, that I want to be a very good citizen of this society that I am part of, so hence I have to serve the economy of the society, but largely to serve myself, because in a given society that is governed by economic relations, unless I serve myself, I won't be able to survive, right? Unless I find a job, I won't be able to survive. Yeah. 1 minute.
Sorry. Having conversation, so it was hard to come down to one instance. There were so many different instances that connect to this thing. But one thing that I recalled was that after my graduation, I was for once planning to go for MBA. And whenever you go for a B school, there's a term called as ROI, return of investment. So you make your choice of the college based on the fact that whatever college you're going, okay, how much you're investing and how much of return would you get and how quick.
Okay.
So that becomes one of the basic condition of choosing what kind of education and what kind of college would you be going for.
So you're pointing to this this narrative that at least in higher education that seems to govern that aim to find a job for oneself seems to govern the educational system. Okay, thank you.
What our last point is, concluding all this, this good job, good salary, a good position, a high education leads to, generating, money. This contribute to our economy, through taxes.
Through taxes, right? Okay.
We pay taxes and all those directly go to economical purpose only.
Okay.
So, that's it.
So, you're saying there is an indirect way in which this actually operates. May not be in that direct sense of the term. Okay. Anything else? Yeah.
When you talked about ki, remember the instances, the one proverb was coming to my mind, which our teachers and parents used to say, ki padhoge likhoge to banoge nawab, kheloge kudoge to banoge kharab. So something like ki, if we study, then only we'll be able to sustain a living, have a living, make a living, and we'll be economically productive for ourselves. And one is if economically productive for himself, and if able to keep some amount aside, so he is automatically economically productive for the nation as well.
Okay. Thank you. I just want you to kind of think a little bit more on whether this particular discourse is also present in primary education, right? And this kind of points to that idea that whenever we want our children to study, right, or do whatever we want them to do, the justification we seem to offer a lot of times to our children is that if you study now, you will have a good future. Future in this sense meaning you will have a good social status, you will have a good job, and you will be able to afford whatever you want to afford. Okay, so that imagination has one way or another captured the public imagination. Okay, it's not to say that the other things don't exist in our discussions, but somehow they seem to be pushed aside, or they're not really that explicitly spoken about in our everyday conversations, right? And that is the point he's making. Standish is also making. He's not really saying that we have to stop thinking about the aim of education as service of the economy, but there is something more that we have to talk about. Okay, now the response generally to this, okay, and we can also see the responses here. Hidden in this, implicitly, the response generally to this is to talk about different set of aims, right? Because you don't like this aims of serving the economy or finding yourself a job, so we immediately talk about different set of aims for education. Okay, give me a different aim that is not directly implicated in the aim of serving the economy for education. You must have heard this aim many times. And especially, at least now, it is hot.
Identity.
Identity could be one.
Respect.
Respect. Society. Okay, so we immediately jump to values, right? So we want to replace what we don't like with another set of aims. One such value being respect, right? What are the other things? 1 minute. So you have to speak into the mic, yeah, sorry.
Transformation of the soul.
Transformation of the soul. I may not maybe, engage with that right now.
Maybe finding self.
Finding oneself.
Oneself.
Okay. I think that would be really a very select group of people who would talk about finding oneself.
Education as a
1 minute. 1 minute. Put your hands up and then we can. Yeah.
Belief.
Okay. Are you saying faith?
Faith.
Faith. Okay. She has to go next. Yeah.
Yeah. Education as input and output.
Education as a input output whatever you taught me and I will output.
Okay, so you're saying that it is conceptualized in an input output relationship.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
And improve thinking.
Thank you. I was looking for that hot word. Improved thinking, which now generally takes this form called critical thinking, right? Critical thinking is another interesting aim of education. And if I put a few more notions there, ideas of aims of education there, you will soon realize that that this actually takes the liberal thinker's route, right? So places it in opposition to vocational idea of education or aims of education. So we talk of something called liberal aims of education. Now, the author Paul Standish says that, you know what, sometimes this fight between the liberal aims and the vocational aims is not going to end so good for the liberal thinkers, okay? The fight is probably going to be won largely by the people who think that the aims of education should be to serve the economy, because that governs our life. Economy actually governs our life. And he says that one of the reasons we actually engage in this particular problem is because the approach that we are taking towards thinking about education and aims of education itself is problematic. Okay? He says that when you think about education either from a liberal aims perspective or from a vocational aims perspective, what you're actually doing is this. And now pay attention, careful attention here, right? What you're actually, you may even go into your minds to figure this out, right, a little bit more. What you're actually doing is, first, you are beginning with deciding an aim for life, okay? Like it is a separate object, okay? So there is an aim that you are imagining. Let's say that this is some kind of a thing, okay? And what you're doing next is that you are actually, out of a set of aims that you might find, you are choosing a few aims, because there could be a huge set of aims, right? You're choosing from a bucket of things, a few things, right? You're drawing out these red balls or black balls from a bucket that has various kinds of balls, right? And after you choose these aims, you are attaching them to, I'm introducing a new term here today, to what are called means, okay? And what is your assumption here? Your assumption is that these means will help you realize the aims. Okay? Take any imagination of this particular sort. I'm just going to do one more small picture and then I'm going to leave it open. Okay? The point is this, that you are first of all imagining an aim. That is, let us say, loosely, a state to be, okay? And the current state here is not the state, because it is not there, right? I mean, it is an absence of the state to be, okay? And you are thinking that you can basically design a set of practices that can actually take you from this state to this state, okay? And what happens largely is that we are placing education as a practice whose only purpose is to get us to the aim that we think are desirable aims for the society or for our own life, okay? So the only purpose of education, I should not even say purpose, the only imagination of education is as a practice or as a means to achieve some aims. Now what is the problem with this imagination? This is the imagination we always have, right? And this is the imagination even R.S. Peters in that particular paper seems to have. Well, Peters has written much more than just that particular paper that Cornel Lamb talks about. You would recognize in that particular paper that Peters doesn't pay attention to the activities that are going to happen in the school, right? There is just a procedure criteria he refers to, but at least in that particular paper, he's not paying attention to the activities because he thinks these activities are means to achieve cognitive perspective, okay? And for him, education itself is an aim which is described as cognitive perspective, state of being that is characterized by cognitive perspective. Even in the second paper, in education as preparation for life, life being understood as vocational, civic, and liberal, education or the set of activities or practices that are happening in schools or in other places are seen as just means to get us there, okay? And I'm not going to kind of get into more details right now. The problem that Standish points to is that when you imagine education as only a means to achieve whatever ends that you've chosen in life or whatever aims that you've chosen in life, you stop, the problem is this, right? That you stop focusing on the means or the good that should characterize the means, and your debate largely surrounds or rests in deciding what should be the aims of education, okay? We'll take a moment to see what argument he's actually presenting here, right? So he says that we have to understand that sometimes, not always, right? Sometimes certain kinds of practices are actually related to aims in what he calls an internal relationship, okay? Before explaining that, I want you to take another 2-3 minutes and try to conceptualize for yourself from your own understanding of what relationships are, what could this actually mean? What do you think an internal relationship could mean? Place it in opposition to external relationships, okay? So what is an internal relationship? Can you please talk to each other and then share for a moment? Right before I kind of start explaining it, I would like to hear your thoughts about it, okay? Okay, so just don't give me another word for that. Try to describe it. Try to go into your minds and capture. Yeah. The question is this. What do you think is internal relationship? Describe it. Think. First, I think it is good to first break down the idea of what a relationship is. When do we say something is in a relationship? Okay? Bond, good. Think about that a little bit more. And then imagine what an internal relationship could be. Just a moment. So maybe if I kind of give you a direction, it will be probably good to go, right? So before describing what this is, what I wanted was for you to think or imagine what could this idea called an internal relationship would be, okay? To understand that, I would want you to kind of take this particular road, okay? First, try to describe for yourself, right? From your own understanding. When I say understanding, you have to go into your minds, right? What does a relationship mean? When we say that something is in a relationship with something, what are the things that we are talking about, right? The simple principle when we say two things are related, okay? I've already given the principle, right? And once you kind of figure that out, you try to figure out, if one has to imagine something called an internal relationship versus an external relationship, what could this actually mean? Okay, I'm giving you another word for you to place it in contrast with and imagine this, okay? So one thing is pretty clear, right? When we say relationship, you are already using the word mutual, that there are two things there, right? Now all you have to imagine is this much. What does it mean to say that these two things are internally related to each other versus these two things are externally related to each other? So relationship and then go tell one again. Yeah, relationship and now already again artha. ಸಂಬಂಧ ರೈಟ್ ಸಂಬಂಧ ಅಂತ ಒಂದು ಆಗಬೇಕು ಅಂದರೆ ಅಟ್ಲೀಸ್ಟ್ ಎರಡು ಕಾರ್ನರ್ ಇರಬೇಕಲ್ಲ ಅದಕ್ಕೆ ಅವಾಗ ಎರಡಕ್ಕೆ ಸಂಬಂಧ ಇದೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತೀವಿ ಅಪ್ನೆ ಏಮ್ಸ್ ಜುಡಾ ಹೋ ಸಕ್ತಾ ಹೈ ಬಟ್ ಅಭಿ ಏಮ್ಸ್ಗೆ ಬಾರೇ ಮತ್ತೆ ಸೋಚಿ ಟೇಕ್ ಅನದರ್ ಆಬ್ಜೆಕ್ಟ್ ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್ ವರ್ಲ್ಡ್ ಜೊ ಆಕೋ ಲಗ್ತಾ ಕಿ ವಾ ಪೇ ಜೊ ದೋ ಚೀಜ್ಕೆ ಬೀಚ್ ಕಾ ಸಂಬಂಧ ಹೈ ವೋ ಇಂಟರ್ನಲ್ ಸಂಬಂಧ ಹೈ ಔರ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟರ್ನಲ್ ನಹೀ ಹೈ ರೈಟ್ ಸಂಬಂಧ ಜೊ ಹೈ ಉಸ್ಕೋ ಇಂಟರ್ನಲ್ ಕರ್ಕೆ ಬೋಲ್ನೆ ಕಾ ಮತ್ಲಬ್ ಕ್ಯಾ ಹೋತಾ ಆಪ್ ಇಂಟರ್ನಲ್ ಕಾ ಮತ್ಲಬ್ ದೇಖಿಯೆ ವಹಾಂ ಪೆ ವೋ ತೋ ರಿಲೇಶನ್ಶಿಪ್ ಹೈ ನಾ ವೋ ತೋ ರಿಶ್ತಾ ಹೀ ಹೈ ಫಾರ್ ಎಕ್ಸಾಂಪಲ್ ದಿಸ್ ಬಾಟಲ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದಿಸ್ ಟೇಬಲ್ ಇಸ್ ಇನ್ ರಿಲೇಶನ್ಶಿಪ್ ರೈಟ್ ಡಿ ಯು ಥಿಂಕ್ ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಎಕ್ಸ್ಟರ್ನಲ್ ಆರ್ ಡಿ ಯು ಥಿಂಕ್ ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಇಂಟರ್ನಲ್ ಗುಡ್ ಸೊ ವಾಟ್ ವುಡ್ ಬಿ ಅನ್ ಇಂಟರ್ನಲ್ ಒನ್ Don't give me an example. Try to describe that idea internally. I'm giving you an example for an external relationship, right? So this bottle and this table are in an external relationship with each other. Okay? Inka relationship external hai, right? So internal ka matlab kya ho sakta hai? Iska opposite kya ho sakta hai? Hum aise bol sakte hain kya ki jab rishta aisa hai ki jo dusra cheez jiske sath hum rishte mein hain वो अपने आप समा है वो रिश्ता इंटरनल हो सकता है मतलब उसको आप निकाल देंगे तो फिर ये चीज़ रहेगा ही नहीं यू सी व्हाट आई एम ट्राइंग टू से बट हियर इफ आई रिमूव द बॉटल दिस टेबल विल स्टिल एग्जिस्ट राइट बट इफ आई रिमूव द प्लास्टिक फ्रॉम दिस बॉटल विल नॉट एग्जिस्ट सो द प्लास्टिक एंड द बॉटल आर इन अ रिलेशनशिप दैट इज ऑफ इंटरनल नेचर Right? The meaning that this is a bottle comes because of also the material that is part of it. Okay? Would you like to give it a go? Just give it a try. I'm sure we are not going to get to the answer today on what an internal relationship is because it requires many layers of sophistication to understand what this could mean, but we can give it a go, right? We can just get into that journey where we come to understand what this is. Who wants to go first?
Is it, means we are not, got totally in that concept.
That's
but
okay.
We are just taking it as an example. Like, is it like a relationship between our heart and mind that we choose our heart to do that and our brain, it allows me to, go through that knowing that course, then step by step making bond with that, and okay, and then at last I said, okay, I have to go with, with my heart and something like that.
Okay.
We're just assuming things.
There are probably you've also said many things here, right? But what I'm going to take out of what you've said is this idea of a bond, okay? Right? So if one has to understand relationship, one has to understand bonding, one has to understand the idea of a connection between two things, right? So that is the first step to understanding what a relationship could mean, okay? others can now share what they think. Yeah.
We had a very basic example that we thought of. If our aim is schooling or education, okay, the practices that lead to a better education. So the main role played there is of a teacher and a student.
Okay.
So the internal relationship of a teacher and a student, mm-hmm, it's not only that the teacher needs to be directive and, you know, have an authority over the student's education, but should be a facilitator. So that internal relationship needs to be built out to achieve our aim in a productive manner.
Okay. You're imagining teacher as a facilitator. Thank you. Valuable idea for us to get into.
Okay.
But right now, I'm still trying to understand what I'm asking for is a description of sorts on what could internal actually mean here. Ram, and then we'll go to the next person. Okay. Yeah.
The external relationship essentially probably looks at me being valuable to, let's say, society or to somebody else or to the nation or to economy or whatever. In the first place, much before I get into an external relationship with the external world, I need to have a internal relationship with myself, which is I define for myself what is my relationship with my thoughts, okay, my desires,
okay,
my purposes,
okay,
a sense of character, yeah, what is my moral structure, yeah. And all of this is also possible during the process of the practice of education, let's say in a classroom. It may not be the course that you're teaching, but it may just be the relationship I have with the other students that may help me get this perspective of who I can be, what I should do,
yeah,
or what my character is and stuff like that,
yeah,
which is, I believe, a self-construct of myself.
Okay. So what I'm taking out of that also is this idea that can one say that the relationship between the idea of self and one's thoughts is an internal relationship. There are two things here, the self and thoughts, and one would be able to say that these two are in an internal relationship, because if you take away thoughts, then the idea of self becomes a little unimaginable.
Yeah, I would say self and the roles.
Okay.
I play functional roles. I play several functional roles in life.
Those, yeah, you would place them as external, right?
No, but psychological construct of my role, and okay, then the expression of that role in the external world.
Okay. Theek hai. Thank you. There is someone else. 1 minute. Yeah.
As we were talking about this, so there was also one of the concepts we came across. So when we were talking about practices of education, generally it is seen as that key reading and writing are the skills one needs to gain so that he can be educated.
Okay.
But we forget to see that ki the internal relationship of reading is reading to understand. And understanding is the aim of education.
Okay.
And writing so that we can reflect upon our thoughts.
Okay. So for you, that there is an internal relationship between reading and understanding. That means that if you actually take away this idea of understanding, there is no reading that is actually happening. That's what you're trying to say.
Yes.
There may be sounds that are being said, but reading in terms also means within itself that there is understanding that is actually happening, right? From these few ideas, what I'm going to present to you is a very, very simple hypothesis, right? To help you imagine a few things, right? So when you say that two things are in external relationship with each other, at one level, you can see them as separate from each other, okay? You can actually separate them, right? So when I say that there is an external relationship, the two things that are related to each other at one level can be separated from each other. Okay? This means, in the context of education, once you decide on the aims, you can tinker with the practices. Okay? Because the practices can be separated from aims. So if you have aims to serve the economy, you will design your education accordingly. If you have liberal aims in mind, you can design your education accordingly. If tomorrow, in a different context, the aim of education is to transformation of the soul, then probably there is a different kind of education that you would imagine for that. So the process of the teacher, the student, the school, and even in other informal contexts of coming together is in itself not important. It's only important because it leads to the achievement of a certain aim. And this is the imagination of an external relationship with each other. Okay? But when you say that there is an internal relationship that two things share with each other, then when you try to separate them, that kind of a separation is not possible. Okay? Because you take one away, the other one will not even exist. Okay? So what Standish seems to point to is that certain kinds of aims, not saying all aims, certain kinds of aims are related to certain kinds of practices within what we call education in an internal relationship. So we should not be trying to separate education and aims very differently, like in that particular sense of the term, but we should also understand that it is within these practices that we do in schools the aims are seen. You see what I'm trying to say? Not that the practices happen today and the aims come tomorrow, right? It's in that very moment that you realize that these aims are being realized. Okay? So in that sense, for him, aims will not be things that one can attach to. Okay? It takes a very different meaning. He would say it is a shorthand. Now, I want to point to something very, very important here, right? If one has to imagine education like this, one needs a different kind of approach to what one thinks of life itself. Okay? And he brings Oakeshott, another philosopher called Michael Oakeshott, to try to imagine life a little differently. And this is going to be a difficult imagination for us. Okay? The reason I'm saying it is going to be a difficult imagination is that it kind of questions our way of thinking itself, right? It kind of shakes us from inside and asks us to think differently. Oakeshott says that education, the statement will look very simple, but it has a great import, right? He says that education is an important aspect of life itself. Place this in contrast to what we discussed in the Winch paper, Winch and Gingell's paper, right? When we spoke of life, the aspects that we imagined were the liberal, the civic, and the vocational as aspects of life, right? As if other aspects may exist, may not exist, but they're not that important, okay? But Oakeshott places education as an important aspect of life itself, that if you take away education from our life, you've taken away something that is extremely, extremely necessary for us. Okay? Not because education leads to some goal, right? That requires one to imagine education in a certain manner, right? And the imagination that Oakeshott gives us, also it has connections with our famous John Dewey, and the imagination is that education is actually what they call a constant renewal, okay? That life actually ends if there is no constant renewal. Otherwise, it is not life, right? It is something that we are living. But if one has to imagine life as a process that renews every moment, then education is what makes that happen, okay? How does it make it happen? By coming into contact with people, by what he calls a conversation. To converse, the Latin root for this particular conversation, the idea of conversation, is to be with someone, right? It is to actually be placed in someone's presence, right? To come into real contact with someone. So what this actually means is that a conversation has no end goal towards which it is actually considered, right, or built around. A conversation actually, when I hear you, and I respond to you, I have to hear you very deeply, right? In this responding to each other, we renew our life, right? New things start emerging, new understandings start emerging in trying to understand the other person and in trying to respond to the other person, right? So two people in a conversation are renewing their life processes themselves, right? In that sense, education is understood as a conversation where there is a constant renewal that is possible, and this constant renewal is an important aspect of life, because if you take this away, then you're taking the whole idea of life away a little bit. Okay? Right? So the connection with human life to education is what makes it a little different from what others are thinking about. Okay, how does it make it different? I just repeat that statement that in this particular case, education or the practices that are encompassed in this idea called education are only important because there are some goals that we have to achieve. Okay, tomorrow, if we can achieve these goals by some other practices, we will as well do it. Okay, just imagine how many of you have seen this movie Matrix? A lot of you have seen the movie, right? So in this Hollywood movie called Matrix, our hero, Neo, is learning a lot of things, right? Some things he learns from his master called Morpheus, okay? And you see them coming into a relationship. And there are a few things that he is learning without anybody teaching him by just these things being transformed into his head directly, okay? There is an electrical connection, and then he wants to learn karate, and everything is just transformed into his head, right? And look at it like that now, which means that education can be replaced. Human relations can be replaced, or the practices that these things encompass can be replaced with other things. And if they can be replaced with other things, because the aims will anyway be met, then these things are not necessary, right? And this idea that I spoke of Matrix, Neo, and other things have some relationship to what he calls technicism, right? That technology, yeah, input-output, that technology can actually solve all our problems, okay? So imagine that tomorrow all our classrooms are replaced with just computers. You want children to learn about democracy? Okay, we have Wikipedia. We'll have a set of activities, games in the computer. Children will all go in the morning. Imagine the situation. They'll all go in the morning. There'll be a set of computers, no teacher there. They'll all put on their microphones, or sorry, headphones or whatever they are, and they will read a set of things on the computer. They will learn about democracy, and they'll come out as democratic citizens. Is this even possible, right? May not be possible at all. In that sense of the imagination, it may not be even possible. Now, what he says is that when you imagine education as just a means to an end, you are actually taking out or throwing away a lot of valuable things that can happen in this idea called education, in this practice called education, and you are very, very, you know, like easily replacing them with other things and losing the value that the previous things had beyond just actually attaining the aims of education. Am I making sense here? Right? You're following me. The replacement of the valuable practices is what he is kind of concerned with. Okay? Now, he goes on to talk about what approach one should take. And he uses Oakeshott again to talk about this new approach. So I'm going to just quickly articulate what Oakeshott seems to say here. Right? He says that these things happen because of the wrong assumption. And what is the wrong assumption? It's already related to this particular idea. And the wrong assumption is that this practice called education can be made meaningful and purposeful by determining a goal first. And this is where you begin from, right? Your goal is first determined, and then calculating a set of practices to achieve this goal. Okay? And we end up calling these set of practices that we have calculated by determining the goal first as education. Okay? And he says this is the problem. Because what happens is that this gains important based on the importance you've given to this. Okay? But if one calls education as an important aspect of life, then the starting point has to be a little different. Okay? And for him, the starting point is this, that we actually have to begin from asking ourselves, why is education important for human life? And try to find a justification that is not based on the goals you can achieve by actually having educational practices, okay? So when you try to find an answer to this question, why is education important for human life? And without going to this as the ground for justification, you will be able to talk about why certain practices are important for human life. Right? Which is, you are actually trying to characterize a practice which is integral with human life. Okay? Human life can be understood as a set of practices. Okay? So you're trying to characterize good practices. And then the task is very simple. Then the task is actually to practice them, to live accordingly. Once you decide that, you know what, this is what human life means, and when I try to understand human life, I understand it as a set of practices that constitute human life. And to make it a good life, I try to characterize what is good about these practices, not by taking a justification from a goal-oriented point of view, right? And that is what he's trying to say there. Just one more point. The point is this, that this need not be understood. The moment I use the word practice, it need not be understood as just a set of activities, okay? He says that practices are basically, they do constitute both knowledge and behavior. Okay? If you say democracy is a practice, it is not just going and going voting, right? Voting is just a behavior that we kind of show evidently, but it also has a certain knowledge of a society, certain knowledge of respect, certain knowledge of everyone's voice. It means much more than just a practice, a behavior of doing something or another, right? So he says that we have to basically try to characterize what a good practice would be to call our own human life as good, and then you would realize that you will have to then characterize this practice called education, where people are coming together in a relationship of learning from each other or many things more, or in a relationship of constant renewal, okay? And then this you can basically characterize as a goal, or he says it is a shorthand expression, that's all. When you say that this is the goal, it is not a thing, it's actually something that constitutes practices and knowledge, behavior and knowledge both, okay? And we might think that, there are few goals in life that are already kind of in line with this, right? I mean, the way we imagine education to be today, etc. But you also understand why Paul Standish is taking this route, because he tries to kind of bring us to this awareness, to this focus, that if you take the split route, the aims and means split route, then you are going to throw away a lot of these things. Yes, Ram.
Again, this goes back to where we started off.
Yeah.
As education being to serve the external economy or society or whatever,
yeah.
Which is the whole point of a goal.
Correct.
And then what Oakeshott says is a wrong assumption.
Correct.
And then looking at it, as a liberal education, where the idea is to set oneself free,
yeah,
and to serve oneself,
yeah,
in a sense, yeah, to,
okay,
to set oneself. So that isn't that the idea? The whole idea of what is valuable to the individual, to appreciate human life better, to achieve his potential or maximize his potential or whatever.
Yeah, thank you for that question. What Sram asking is, how is this different from liberal education?
Yes,
right. Isn't liberal education actually trying to say the same thing by using ideas such as intrinsically worthwhile, etc.? The response that Standish himself gives in this paper is that he calls liberal education, or the way liberal aims are conceived of, as only a benign way of utilitarianism. Okay, that yes, it is not as strong as serving the economy is, but it is still a weak way of thinking of education because it still kind of creates the split between aims and means. Am I making some sense here? Okay. Liberal mein bhi ye sab cheeze hain, toh kya problem hai? Wo bol rahe hain, but phir bhi wahan pe thinking aisa lag raha hai that these two are separate. Okay. And then the practice is, and this you will see quickly when you basically look at what liberal thinkers are actually talking of when they talk of the manner of education. Okay. Especially when you talk of the UK, they don't seem to spend too much of time thinking about what should happen as part of pedagogy in the classroom, okay? As part of their liberal thinking itself, right? It's thought of as a little differently, right? But they'll just talk of these things as separate from the idea of cognitive perspective itself, right? For them, cognitive perspective is the final goal, and other practices should lead to that goal. And whichever practice is not leading to that goal, you can throw it away and you can replace it with something else. But while throwing it away, is it important for us to also see what value it had, even if it did not actually achieve the goal of cognitive perspective, something that we have to pay attention to. That's all one is pointing to here. Okay? Is this making sense? Yeah. You all understood what is internal relationship, right? That if you remove that, then the other thing, it's going to be hard for the other thing to exist. Yeah.
Just a small doubt is that when we are saying that we should begin from why is education important for human life?
Yeah.
This thought is to be provoked inside the self, the individual, or as, again, a part of society? And
I think as a part of society, right? This will somehow, the point is, there is also an emphasis on this word, human life itself. Okay? And that is how the paper ends. That this also means, thinking about education also means not just thinking about education as goal, as ends to something else, as means to something else, but it also means we have to understand what does it mean to be human. We have to really understand our own state, and it's a very interesting demand that he places on us, right? That only when we take that particular route, we will be able to see the place of education as a conversation for human life, okay? How it makes human life's a valuable pursuit in itself.
So yeah. Would that mean that again as a society we have to come to a common consensus of definition of why is education important to human life?
Yeah, so should we come to a consensus or not?
Because that would also lead to the question if the practices have to be similar for everyone or not. Hmm. And back to the question, do we have a similar set of values or do we have different?
Yeah, so I think the quick response to that is while we value consensus, definitely, right now, from Standish's paper itself, we don't have to really worry about consensus right now, right? The reason is, he also points to this, right? The consensus cannot be arrived if we are already imagining education like this. Also because this kind of thinking will not even emerge, because we're all tuned to thinking in a certain manner. Probably, thank you for bringing that idea of consensus, probably we will have to question the grounds of consensus also. Right? We all coming to consensus means that everything is right. May not be. Right? We may all be thinking in a certain manner and hence we are all coming to this consensus. Probably we will have to question our own consensus from that particular place. Right? And that makes a lot of sense here. Yeah.
So are we trying to change the goal here or like nullify it and not have a goal at all?
No. What would others say? Are we trying to change the goal here?
Re-understand the goal.
Thank you. It's actually restructuring or re-understanding what is a goal. You see, not just changing the goal, but kind of going back to our own minds and asking ourselves, what is a goal and what does this constitute of? Okay? And what kind of goals require external practices to be achieved? And what kind of goals are already related with a set of practices themselves? Okay? It needs a different understanding of what a goal is. And if Paul Standish has achieved that much through this paper, I think we are successful. Anna? Can we just quickly recollect the important points that we've discussed? Beginning with, in the paper only, right? Beginning with this idea that the concept of education is contested, right? That many people will have different conceptions of education, which means the aims of education are also contested and controversial, because any aim that you choose will be contextual, right? So it will be contextual, which will be political and historical and personalized. Right. But the other approach is that aims are not actually controversial. They are very commonsensical. And the most commonsensical aim is education should serve the economy. But when you respond to that aim by getting all angry about education serving the economy, you end up also taking their same road by articulating a different set of aims for education. And his problem is both of these are problematic because they are using a particular framework of thinking where aims are separated as objects, as things, and educational practices are imagined as only means to those things. And where does this get interesting? It gets interesting because human life is seen in a relationship only with aims, as if human life need not be seen in the relationship with the practices that are helping one to achieve those aims. He is making a shift there, right? He is trying to show us that, you know what, probably, not just probably, but yes, the practices themselves that we call as education are important for human life itself, okay? Not just because they lead you to some aims, but because they are valuable in our understanding of what does it mean to be human, okay? And that's where he uses this metaphor of education as conversation. Conversation is not directed towards a goal, but conversation is a constant renewal process where, very interesting point he makes, where the teacher and the student do not come in a hierarchical relationship. They come in an equal relationship with each other because the teacher does not assume that he knows everything, and the student does not assume that the teacher knows everything, right? Both of them are ready to challenge each other because both of them are students to themselves, right? And that is the interesting point that emerges from this paper, from the idea of conversation also, okay? And that is what is constant renewal, and that is what is true education, okay? Now it may be hard for us to really understand all of these points, also because our own focus on our life may be a little different, right? What is important to our life may be a little different, and hence it may be very hard for us to imagine all of these things. But I'll just give you an example and then close the discussion there, okay? Even if, for example, we say that getting a job and being economically prosperous is important to my life, okay? The idea of constant renewal will have to be applied there as well, okay? Am I really happy in the job that I am doing, right? Am I feeling fulfilled in the job that I am actually doing? Am I making sense here, right? And is this the nature of job that I want to do always, right? Is this particular occupation that I am engaged in, is it alienating me in any way or another, right? And that is the constant renewal where you are in a conversation with yourself, with your own decisions in life, and you are asking yourself these questions over and over again and again. And that is also an educative experience that is, in that sense, self-generated, right? So aapka life ka focus kuch bhi ho, okay? It is important for us to really keep constantly renewing ourselves, and that is what education means here. For me, it is actually the sentences that I speak, right, in a classroom. I'm just giving that example so that we understand this much more. And it doesn't happen all the time, right? The constant renewal here will be to speak a sentence and ask oneself about what one has spoken. Okay, what is it that I've assumed in speaking this particular sentence? And be in a relationship with myself and constantly renew myself is what is also required here, okay? So in the next class, we are going to go into the second section and the third section, which is on liberal education and the idea of vocational education and progressivism. He's bringing all these arguments for us to understand this a little more expansively and a little more deeply as well, okay? Is that fine? Any questions that you have now? Did you understand these main points that we discussed today? I urge you to talk to each other and then clarify these points as well, okay? Thank you for being a good audience.
Hello and welcome to this interaction. As you know, this interaction is about your philosophy of education class this morning. I wanted to begin by asking, what did you think of the class? How did it go?
Subject is pretty complex, okay, philosophy of education, because we are trying to learn what education is. And then you come with certain predefined notions of what education should be, even when you've taken admission to this course. This is the third reading. And it so happens that we've been having contradictory views mm-hmm. on what education is by different authors. And today's class was particularly good because the way professor taught it is also, in a sense, trying to clarify and consolidate the learning from the other classes as well.
Okay,
I think I have to say a similar thing, that when you say philosophy of education, it's more about the belief system of how the entire education system works. So today's class gave us a view about the basis of it in a different angle, and also what is the actual need of understanding education. So I kind of really could relate to today's class, and I think it was really productive in a lot of ways. So mm-hmm. I really liked it. Yeah.
Today's class is very good. As Ram said, that we have previous two papers. Within that, we are learning that aims of education and what is the concept of education tells. Slightly, it's difficult for us to understand the third paper because there was some complicated terms which mm-hmm. we have faced today. So it is good today, but it is quite hard and, to know the central meaning of this paper.
I see. Why did you think you found it hard? What is it that you found hard about?
Because
class?
The first two first and second paper which tells, it's slightly difficult. I'm getting difficult to relate these two meaning of the third paper.
Okay.
Because there are some authors like Peters, what say Peters, Winch, and now these papers. So there is little difficult for mm-hmm. me to understand this today's mm-hmm. class.
Also, the different education is there, like Peter and all, they have analyzed in a different way how that particular the concept will be. So that's why we were just like understanding, we tried to understand what the author is saying particularly about that concept. And also we tried to relate that into the practical thing. And we need a more clarity regarding the concept what okay. the sir have taught for us.
Mm-hmm. For each of you, for whatever you understood, is there a key learning that you can share from today's class?
There were quite a few. The major thing that I think I took up is constant renewal that was mentioned, that it's about education is not about you making a goal and reaching towards it, but it's a continuous process. And education is more about knowing you as a human being first mm-hmm. and not about achieving something in life and then being recognized. So that is something that I'm going to take away, that it is, even once I achieve a goal, the basic thing that even sir mentioned is that ask yourself, are you happy where you are? Mm-hmm. And how has the entire process been while you were reaching that goal? So for me, I think a lot of things about how we from childhood have been, you know, trained to have a goal in mind and then practice things to reach to that goal. But actually, the education system should be like we are practicing things and understanding and then reaching or formulating our goal then. So it was really productive for me.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's interesting, yeah.
And one thing is, it should not be occasional for everyone. Being educated to get a job, it's not what make that much sense. We have to understand what is going on in the society and all. We have to understand the terms, what we will daily go through, and it should not be a vocational, but it should be a self transformation into something.
Okay.
Yeah, throughout this course we've been learning about what is being seen, okay, how is it being seen, and by whom
yeah.
that seeing is happening, okay,
right.
And the confusion or some of the contradictions in our learnings as we learn is because there are different perspectives from different points of view. So for example, it could be from the perspective of the learner, the education system itself, or it could be from the perspective of a teacher, or it could be from the perspective of the system, or it could be from the perspective of the policymaker. Mm-hmm. How does he or she see the aims, objectives, purposes, values? And therefore, today's class again was a key learning because you again saw different kinds of education, whether it's liberal or vocational, again from the point of view of the individual, mm-hmm. or in today's specific class, as the author says, from a point of re-understanding the goal of education from a perspective of what is its value to human life itself. Okay. So that's the key learning. So can we look at it from the perspective totality or the wholeness mm-hmm. of what does it mean to a human life? Okay. So that's, I think, key, because ultimately education without humanism or humanity can become quite meaningless also.
Right. Okay. Would you like to share your key learning?
Today I learned that the practices and the aims, there is an interrelationship between the practices and the aims. We cannot divide this because they are interrelated to each other. I just learned these things today very much, and that's it.
Okay. How do you see the value of prior reading in your philosophy of education class? Because I think that is an expectation that a reading is given prior to the class and you are expected to read. And as you all shared, that philosophy of education is a complex course, right? It requires a certain form of thinking. Do you think prior reading is helpful, or what would you say to that? Or does it help to read after the class is over and the concepts have been discussed in class?
The prior reading is very helpful for us. By reading those concepts before entering into the class, we will what came when the concept will be clear after whatever the sir will taught for us, and we will just the concept will be clear for us, what is happening, what the author is trying to say, and we can relate this with the practical life, and also we can think the same what we will call it as that particular thing in a different angles, and we will just analyze that thing.
Mm-hmm. I think it is really beneficial because it makes you become a they say critical thinking is very important to adapt, especially when you're doing such a course. So it really helps. But it also depends on the faculty, is what I believe. The way they're carrying forward the lessons or the readings is very important. Even if sometimes, for some reason, if you've not done, today's class really helped me, even though I wasn't that very sure of the context because I just done layman reading. So I think it is important, very important, like based on, but even if you don't do it, depends on the faculty, how they're taking, and the methods that they're using to teach that particular class.
I just want to answer this question. See, I think a subject like philosophy again can be filled up with a lot of jargon, yeah, and you can get easily diverted by different opinions of different philosophers, yeah.
Right.
And ultimately, as a learner, the whole objective would be to take your position mm-hmm. in the face of all these opinions, not necessarily a hard position, but at least form a clear opinion as to which position you want to take. Yeah, so that you have a clear concept of what it meant for you. Mm-hmm. And in order to do that in a classroom setting, yeah, and with other students and with the professor being able to guide you, it would be very useful if you can form an opinion mm-hmm. and test that opinion in the class by asking questions or challenging the... Okay. Because there have been many an occasion where I have had a very hard opinion. I mean, I thought this is the way it should be. And then during the process of questioning the professor, his clarification, and then my own questioning of the concept, understanding myself, I've changed my view of how I looked at it.
Which is very important.
Which is very important as a part of learning.
And leading from there, you said that it helps to clarify things with the professor. Does it also help, as I noticed in the class today, that your instructor wanted you to discuss the arguments that he was making in pairs? So is it helpful to talk with peers? How do you see that as an interesting. I thought it was a very interesting form of pedagogy to use in a philosophy of education class. How do you see that as being valuable for the classroom discussions that you have in philosophy of education?
I think it was really, really helpful because there are times that you're very confused with the way you're thinking, especially right. in a class like philosophy, because people have different linkages. Like they might all think in different directions and are not sure if it's right. So that really helped because when you're talking to somebody else, if you're right or if you're wrong or if whatever is the confusion, it kind of gets clear and kind of gives you a boost to know if you're on the right track or if you're understanding it right or not. And then you can speak up in the class and interact with the professor. So I think that was a very good thing that was done because the ones who were quiet also were having an understanding. So it was really beneficial.
Mm-hmm. The subject like philosophy needs more conversation within the students. Because we have, in this diverse class, we have difference of opinions and their experiences are different. So by this experience, we can learn something. It will be benefits and sometimes some who are not participating, he will also get us something
right.
In that. That's.
I also found, apart from conversation, as you mentioned, being a very, very important pedagogic tool in philosophy of education, I found that your instructor also uses a concept map as a pedagogic tool. How do you feel about that? Does it help to clarify arguments, especially made in the readings? Or?
Yeah, so there are two ways I looked at the pedagogical aspect. Okay, one, you can come top down mm-hmm. and come with all the jargons and try to explain the jargons. I mean, the technical meaning of those philosophical words and build the concept from there.
Right.
And there is a reading which serves as a context, okay? Or you can use a conversation mechanism to start from ground up, the commonsensical use of the word, and then use these concept maps to build the concept. Mm-hmm. So I think the way professor is doing it, especially for a class which is relatively new to these concepts, is actually probably a very good approach to making the first philosophical understanding of a subject like education.
Okay. Would you like to add anything?
Yeah. By seeing that conceptual map, we will just we can understand that the main point, what is that particular sentence is saying about, and also we will get a clear picture of a whole entire reading by seeing that conceptual map actually.
Mm-hmm. Do you think at some point of time you will be able to construct your own concept maps? Do you try based on the readings and based on this practice that is followed in this class? Do you feel that you can perhaps develop this ability to do that?
Yeah, I think we can definitely do that because it helps us understand the core areas and how you link it and how you justify things and what it leads to. So it helps you understand even when you want to, you know, for self-explanation as well as when you want to use it for others, it's really helpful and gives you the proper links.
Mm-hmm.
And from various points that, you know, the interlinks and all are really well explained. So I think it's benefiting everyone and we will use it, I think. Yeah. And I think even majority of us even do that, but we don't do it knowingly. So now that we know it really works well, so we've understood the crux of it well.
Anything else that anybody wants to add? Okay. It was a wonderful conversation. I think I got very, very interesting insights from the students' perspective, having attended the class, but from a different position. So thank you all very much for your time and participating in this interaction. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir.